So I think we've overrun a little bit, and obviously the last talk for Digital Journeys, working for Waze, being a SatNav app, we're quite conscious of time, so I'm going to try and save it and get us to the end of our journey with hopefully a couple of minutes to spare. First show of hands, well actually, over the next 25 minutes I'm going to talk about three main things. Firstly, the Waze application, our approach to the problem of traffic. Secondly, I'm going to talk to you about how through open source data, our different approach is able to solve a lot of solutions, and how we quickly moved from a SatNav app into a transportation company. And the last element I'm going to talk to you about how we work closely with brands to help fund all the innovation within Waze. So to kick off, first show of hands, how many of you people are aware of Waze? So pretty much everyone, excellent. So this is how most people think of Waze. They think of it as a SatNav app that you download from the App Store or the Play Store, and you dock your phone onto the dashboard of your car and away you go. Off you go, we drive you from A to B in the quickest time possible. And most people are aware that the way we do this, different to other SatNav platforms, is through crowdsourcing all of our users' data. And hopefully, out of the 65% of the population that drove into work this morning, and of those that use Waze, this is how they should have felt. So maybe not exactly like this, but something along those lines. We're known as the application that saves you time driving from A to B. But this is how we think of Waze. We think of Waze more of an ecosystem where gathering people together should be the source of everything we do. So what I mean by that is, this is an image taken from an event at Mountain View last year. And we hold these events where it's not just incorporating people from Waze, but what we do is also invite along other people that are also influencers within transportation. So what I mean by that is departments of transports, for example, municipalities, other people where they want to have the common purpose to defeat the objective of traffic. At the same time, we also bring along people that work within our communities. So volunteers, people that don't work for Waze, but they spend a lot of their own personal time trying to update the maps in their own personal time. And since 2008, we've now built a community of over 110 million community drivers. And if you accumulate all of the miles that our users drive on a monthly basis, that equates to over 18 billion miles driven in-app per month. So you can start to see, in a lot of the most busiest congested cities across the world, the amount of data that we have and the amount of control that we have in these cities is next to none. And one of the main elements of Waze that makes us different to other SatNav platforms is the fact that users can provide their own user-generated reports. So what I mean by this is, either vocally or via the tap of a button on your hands-free device, you can publish a report and let other Wazers know around your area that you're either stuck in heavy traffic, or there's a nearby police stop, or there's been an incident such as a car crash or a hazard. And the value of this information is vital. So this is a tweet from someone called Rebecca Jackson. She's actually quite a famed motoring journalist and racing car driver. So I'll read it out because you probably can't see it from the back. Anyone on the roads tonight, be careful. Certain roads, the M4, the A21, the A329. If you have it, run at Waze because it verbally warns you of stopped cars in road and on the hard shoulder. Great for extra road safety. There are not enough cars to keep the tarmac snow and ice free in the treacherous conditions out there. So if you stop and pause and think what this means, what this is highlighting is, this is a traffic report provided by another community member, so another Wazer, up ahead of the incident that she's approached, and she's had a verbal warning via Waze. During this time of Beast in the East and this treacherous road conditions, where that extra little bit of information is vital in the element of road safety. So as she approaches that incident, she's had this verbal warning on Waze telling her to beware, there is an incident up ahead, and to make sure that no more accidents would occur in and around the area. And right at the top of our community of drivers are what we call map editors. So I've been at Waze now for a year and a half now, and this still shocks me. There are over half a million map editors across the world. And what a map editor is, is they basically have a desktop version of Waze, which is pretty useless for you in terms of driving inside your car. But what they do on that is they spend a lot of their own personal time to update the roads in and around the areas they live. So the King Map Editor in the UK, he spends on average 40 hours a week updating all the information around Waze in the UK. On a regular basis, he gets together with other map editors and map enthusiasts to make sure that the Waze map in the UK is thoroughly up to date. And if you think about why they do this, there's no the only real value is altruism. They do it for the sheer sake of they think that they're going to help other people get from A to B, and their maps in their areas are the most up to date. And on average, we see over 50 million edits from these map editors. And just to show you how much they love it, this is an image of our King Map Editor in Ukraine, drives around in his own brand of car. So in some pockets of the world, in certain cities like LA, take for example, we have so many users that we effectively control the traffic in LA. And some local residents, they don't like the algorithms, how Waze work. And this is an example of a local community getting together, putting up a signage saying, don't trust your application, please don't drive along our private residential roads. But the reason why this happens is there's only so many roads, there's only so many shortcuts, and there's inundation of cars that are flooding the roads of LA during busy commuter hours. So we decided to do something about this. And 2 years ago, we created an organization called the Connected Citizens Program. And what CCP effectively is a two-way data exchange where we give our data to municipalities, departments of transport. And in that space of 2 years, we now partner with over 500 DOTs across the world. And we give them our real-time traffic data from our community of 110 million drivers for free. In return, what we get from them is advanced road closures. So advanced road closures based on events such as the London Marathon, or advanced road closures because of roadworks. And obviously living in London, we know how extensive that can be. So on the Waze application, this extra level of data that you see on the map is the reason why we're able to find that extra shortcut and that extra reroute to save drivers time. And to put this into life a little bit more, so take for example, Traffic for London. What we provide for Traffic for London is this heat source. So this is an image of all of the types of traffic data that is user-generated reports from our drivers on the go. And if we take, for example, the latest tube strikes in February, by 8 a.m. that morning, our community of drivers had already provided over 100,000 traffic reports to TfL HQ by 8 a.m. that morning. Now, they use that information to plan extra routes, to open up more bus routes, to play around their traffic grid, to tackle that issue of traffic on that problematic day. And in that space of time with TfL, as an example, in 18 months, we've now grown from, as part of their data stack, in understanding real-time road conditions in London, and we're now their number one data provider in understanding what is the real-time road conditions currently like. So 2 years ago, believe it or not, despite how powerful Waze is, there was a function that was lacking on Waze, and that was speed limits. So our approach to tackling this issue was somewhat different. So what we did is, via machine learning and also working with our community of drivers, what we did is we looked at the driving data and we actually predicted on all the segments of roads across the world, what is our prediction of the speed limits from that. So this is a great example of how, through our community of people that want to get involved, the element of altruism, these 500,000 map editors, we worked with them to help them validate the speed limits across all of these segments. And we launched this in a matter of weeks. So this is a quick way of how we took machine learnings, working with the community that we built together, to then create speed limits across our application, across all the markets that we operate in. And as a result, what we've seen in terms of the impact for drivers as a safety measurement, what we saw is that we've actually decreased the average speed in open roads for Wazes by over 2 kilometers an hour. So this element of safety, we've been able to get Wazes to drive slower and safer through this smart way of delivering speed limits within the application. Now, building maps across all these different markets where their efforts for congestion in each municipality and each city is vastly different can be somewhat expensive. So this is an example. I'll take an example in France. In France, they use a sticker system. So this sticker system effectively, from 1 to 5, whatever sticker you might have determines certain roads that your car, based on emissions, are allowed to drive on during different times of the week and different hours of the day. And in Jakarta, they're a lot more far right in their approach. It's simply an even number plate or an odd number plate. And based on your number plate, you're only allowed to drive into Jakarta on certain days of the week. But within our function, what we've done is that we're the application that makes sure that you don't drive into your city centre with the incorrect badge or with the incorrect number plate and get a fine through the post a few days later. But the funny thing is that even though we provide this service, in a lot of cities, they still try to hack this approach. So the example of somebody driving in Jakarta with an even plate, a number plate, and I think what it is, their real number plate as well. So on to partnerships. So the integration of your smartphone into your car is obviously a vast amount of space where we can significantly improve that experience for a driver. So teaming up with Spotify, what we've effectively done is it's a deep link integration where teaming up with Spotify, you can have your Spotify playlist on the top half of your same screen, along with the Waze application on the bottom half. So effectively what this is not converting from one application to another if you have your phone docked onto your car. And an even deeper element of partnerships that we've delved into is working with OEMs. And we're seeing a big migration from those that dock their smartphone on their dashboard, and they start using Waze as an application that's integrated into the dashboard of their car. So a lot of this is being driven via Android Auto, and also Apple CarPlay as a recent release. But if you think about the data that we'll start picking up, once the Waze application is able to take data from, take for example, the environmental sensors within your car, we can start picking up if you're braking heavily based on the greasy road and provide that information to other Wazers that are about to approach that same segment of the road. And what we anticipate is announced only this week, Waze is now accessible via Apple CarPlay. We'll start seeing a much larger percentage of our users start to use Waze baked in into the cars that they drive. So what we're going to summarise of what I've covered in the last 10 minutes is how we've moved from simply the Waze application that most of you are familiar with, how we've built an infrastructure and become effectively a transportation company. So all of the data that we take from our users, all of the user-generated reports that they provide, how we pass that on to municipalities and other organisations within CCP to help alleviate traffic in the busiest cities in the world. And also on the communications front. So we partner with over 500 radio stations, TV broadcasters. Effectively, we're the eye in the sky. So we're the traffic and news. We power the traffic and news for over 500 radio stations and TV broadcasters across the world. And again, we provide all this data for free. In return, obviously, the value there is that we're known as associated with powering that information. The map owners community, like we've covered already, and Waze Carpool. So Waze Carpool is our big bet. While a lot of futurologists will probably tell you another 10, 15 years until we reach fully autonomous driving cars and cities that will facilitate that, we believe that because we built a community of 110 million drivers, effectively a social network of drivers, our solution until we reach that point of time is connecting riders with drivers. And because within Waze, you feel a bit more comfortable with knowing that you'd be potentially jumping in the car of another Wazer, this is our solution of making sure that we're not getting more and more drivers out there that effectively drive to work with 4 empty seats. If you feel like keeping your car at home, why not pick up another Wazer and help tackle the problem of traffic in your city by leaving your car at home? So we've launched this across 10 cities in the US, and we'll soon be developing this further into other cities across the world. So I suppose the big question is how do we fund all of this innovation? And that's where brands get involved. So where our data is really rich is we talked about the billions of miles that our drivers cover. But the information we have is obviously we understand where somebody starts a journey, where they finish a journey, and everything in between. So at the same time of building our application, we've also built a location-based marketing platform, that being Waze Ads. And if we look into the category of grocers, so where grocers and grocer brands really delve in and benefit with our location-based marketing platform is they understand that we've got a deep understanding of when people drive to grocer locations, broken down by the weekday and the weekend, also broken down by the hour of each of those days. But what becomes really interesting is if you apply this knowledge to specific key moments of context during the over the course of any given day. So it's 4 o'clock right now. Quick show of hands. How many of you think you know what you're going to have for dinner tonight? So not many. So the truth is apparently 60% of the population still don't know what they're going to have for dinner by 5 p.m. In an evening. So this is a great moment of context of how a grocer can connect with a driver on their commute home and target them with an ad and give them a solution of, well, if you still don't know what you're going to have for dinner tonight, why don't you pop in and buy this potential offer? So we see the likes of M&S, Lidl, and even Domino's Pizza. So even if you can't be bothered to cook that evening, they can send a remind me notification so that when you reach home, it's a remind me notification of you to place your order with Domino's. And what's unique about the Waze Ads platform is for us, our key metric is all about navigations. How many people are we getting to reroute and drive to bricks and mortar locations? And it's all simplified via a drive there CTA that we use. So within the Waze application, you receive an ad and you have the potential to physically reroute to that promoted location. So to delve a little bit further on what M&S did, and particularly during last December, so a very competitive month, where a lot of grocers are competing with each other for footfall, and the Christmas missions that we see people visiting grocers in the month of December. What they did is use a variety of 12 different creatives, pre-Christmas, during Christmas Day, and after as the run-up to New Year's. And it was targeting those Christmas missions of whether it's you still need to buy your Christmas turkey, festive treats, or party foods for the New Year's. And what they did is they basically dominated the platform on Waze to make sure that people are aware of M&S locations and M&S offerings during those key moments of the day. And as a result from our navigation data, what we saw is that M&S moved from the 8th most visited grocer across the Waze platform and jumped up all the way to being the 4th most visited platform by promoting their locations on the Waze app. And what was interesting is that we also saw where they took these navigations from their competitors, so effectively taking market share from their biggest rivals. I'm now going to show you a video of how we combine Waze data and we link that up with client data to deliver really impactful media campaigns. Well, that didn't work. Should we try that again? Yes.
No one knows how to outsmart traffic better than Waze, the most popular traffic app in Brazil. But no one knows better than SulAmerica, the country's largest auto insurance company, that the fastest route is not always the safest. So, we cross-matched a huge amount of data generated by millions of users of both companies to make streets safer for everyone. SulAmerica City Watch. We mapped out thousands of locations with high numbers of incidents throughout the country's major cities. Incidents like car thefts, accidents with pedestrians, dangerous intersections, accidents in bike lanes, and many more. We then used all this information to send geo-targeted alerts to Waze users before they get into trouble.
Dangerous intersections ahead. Please drive carefully. Please slow down and watch out for the pedestrians. Area with high rates of car theft, park safely. There's a bike lane in the street. Keep a safe distance.
In an ambitious media partnership, instead of using 23 million impressions to advertise products, Sun America used it to make drivers safer.
O que a gente está fazendo é realmente prestação de serviço. A gente quer é ser relevante para as pessoas.
This is the first time we've seen a brand doing a service for the drivers in such high scale. We are seeing app recall numbers way above the average.
Sul America City Watch.
Yes, that's a great example of an insurance brand raising awareness of accident areas to push and promote their brand to a 100% driving audience. So one of my favorite campaigns at the moment is what we're doing with VW, Golf GTI. So what Golf wanted to do is that they wanted to promote the joy of driving a GTI. And what better way to do that than highlight great super drive locations across the UK. So what we did is that we accessed all of our users' driving data. We determined which roads saw the most amount of turns, which roads also had the highest average speeds, the least amount of traffic, and the least amount of accidents across the UK. And what we ended up with was 75 of the best driving routes that a Waze could go and enjoy the experience of a GTI Superdrive. And we highlighted these locations with quite a unique pin on the map that resembles a scenic location in terms of UK driving images. And to make the campaign even more delightful for our users, we offered them the opportunity to change their flying arrow into an actual Golf GTI so that you could actually feel the passion of driving a Golf on the Waze application. So the client loved this so much. We've delivered so many GTI Superdrive experiences. They actually extended this two-month campaign for an additional month into the month of November as well. And I'm going to leave you lastly with probably the most native way that brands can get involved on the Waze application. And that's through using celebrity voice talents to take over the voice guidance on Waze. So in Christmas 2016, we used Sue Perkins' voice from Celebrity Bake Off, and she was basically driving people home for Christmas in that month of December. But what we also see is film brands, so film clients, film launchers, they love this execution. So we've had the vocal talent of Arnold Schwarzenegger, during Terminator Genesis, and also Morgan Freeman for London Has Fallen, offering the vocal guide for a month prior to the launch of that film. So that's me done. I hope over the talk I've explained to you how Waze is vastly different through using crowdsourced data of our users, through our open data policy, how we've been able to build ourselves into a transportation brand and how we're influential with so many cities that need to tackle the problem of traffic, and how brands work smartly with us on our platform through our location-based marketing solution. Thank you.